Hello and welcome to What's a Mortgage and the House Heroes Tuesday Night Live. As you can see, I'm missing one of my cohorts tonight, Troy Reed. He had a crazy night. He's out doing final walkthroughs, delivering keys, and had some showings. So I don't think he's making it back in time tonight. But thank you guys for joining us here on What's a Mortgage and the House Heroes. You know, as you know, we come live Tuesday night and we bring you what's happening, what we're seeing from the trenches in the real estate market. And so tonight I'm going to be talking about the five things. Again, we're on part four of this five-part series. And basically what we want to get at is when you go to view a home for the first time, there are five key things you want to look at so that once you get in and you're all excited to buy this home, when that home inspection rolls through, you're not surprised at what's called out. And it doesn't just destroy your plans. You know, you don't want to be all excited, you know, sketching out your kitchen remodel. You got all your Pinterest, you know, file going. And next thing you know, home inspection rolls through. You need new plumbing. You need new electrical. Maybe even need a new roof. And that's going to put priority over your awesome kitchen remodel. And some of you are just scraping by to get in that house. You know, we understand it. I mean, I remember buying my first home. You know, I'm sitting there trying to cut pennies any which way I could. And I just wanted to get in the biggest houses I could. And I had $0 in my pocket when it was all said and done. And I needed every little dollar to get me across that finish line. And sure enough, I bought that house within a week. The whole side fence blew over. And, you know, I got the neighbor knocking on my doors and I'm like, man, that's messed up. The other neighbor brought me a pie, you know, and you're bringing me a broken fence. And so, like, I remember those days. And, you know, what we want to do is, you know, we put our 20 years of experience, you know, understanding homes, being a licensed contractor myself. You know, I want to put some of those things and pitfalls in front of you up front, not to discourage you, but just so you can make the right decision. And so that's what we've been talking about, the five things. Tonight we're going to be talking about the roof and what you need to know when you're walking through that property. Simple things you can visualize. You know, what type of roof is it? You know, what's that condition? So anyways, if you guys have any questions, we're here for you. We want to answer any questions you have. When I say we, I guess it's just me tonight. So go ahead and shoot out. I'm going to be monitoring the What's a Mortgage page on any comments. So let me pull that up right now and make sure the volume's down. Awesome. What's up, Raphael? Good seeing you. Monica, again, please give me just a thumbs up, you know, a shout out, a little love. If you guys like what you're seeing, you know, again, our goal here is to educate and empower you so that you have the knowledge when you're out there buying a home, you have the comfort, you understand what's going on. I know there's a lot coming at you guys and, you know, you're just trying to do the best. You know, number one, you know, get with a good realtor, get with a good lender, somebody you can trust, and they'll walk you through it step by step. But there are things you can be doing now to kind of get yourself ready for that moment. So let's jump into it. So we normally like to start with a little in the news. Since I'm on my own tonight, I'm going to keep it short. And this was a Dear John letter. This is the ultimate kiss off that Troy got today for one of his clients. It was painful. And this is where the market is, you know. And it basically, he's asking, when did the seller plan to make a decision on an offer he had submitted? And the response is, hello. We received over 80 offers and the seller cut them down to conventional with the highest down payment. So unfortunately, if your offer was FHA, seller would not be countering. So, you know, we still have multiple offers out there in the field. Make sure that you guys are, you know, getting with your agent, you're talking about strategies, and you're only looking at homes you really can afford. Unfortunately, some of these agents, you know, this agent, you know, honestly, I have nothing nice to say about him in this case. He just priced it too low. You know, why break 80 people's hearts? You know, 3 offers is enough. 10 offers is perfect. 80 offers, that's just a joke. He underpriced it. He wanted to get multiple offers. He wanted to show off to his client. But really all he did was break hearts and waste people's time. So, you know, there are multiple offers out there. The market's still hot. But this is the best buying season. You know, we've seen a run up. The number that just came out, I saw on Orange County Register today, 17% year over year gain in value. So if you were one of those last year going, oh, I don't know where the market's going to be in 2020, recession, this, that, you missed a 17% just complete run up in price and equity loss. So what we're expecting right now is more of the same into next year. We're expecting to continue with low interest rates still, and we're expecting to have a lack of inventory. We don't see anything that we can predict on the horizon. We follow a lot of economists out there, and we do not see anything. They haven't indicated anything that they see this is the ultimate, you know, downfall of real estate, what's going to bring in foreclosures and stuff like that. So right now it's just, you know, we're on that path. So, you know, barring something completely detrimental, you know, a terrorist attack, something that's fully unforeseen, you know, natural disasters, things like that, we really don't see anything changing in this real estate landscape. But if you guys are out there, don't get depressed. You got to keep forging ahead. You know, I had three offers get accepted yesterday for clients. Two of them, they told me right off the bat, you were not the highest offer. We liked how thorough your offer was. We liked the cover letter you sent about your clients. We liked the whole package, and my sellers really got behind you and your clients. And so luckily I had good agents I could talk to on those, and sometimes you get lucky. But what we are seeing is we're seeing a ton of showings, but I feel like we're seeing a few less offers. So I feel like some of my clients that were getting beat out before and just completely out of the ballpark offers coming in, I feel like there's a little pullback to reason right now. People aren't going 2% and 5% over the last accepted offer a week earlier. I feel like it's staying close to that last property that sold. So, you know, if property is listed at 600 and it went for 650, that next property is still going for that 650, 655. It's not jumping up to 675, 700 right off the bat like we saw a month and a half ago. So if you guys are out there, keep chugging along, and let's jump into the roof. So today we're gonna hit number 4 on our list, which is El Techo. If you guys are doing a preview for Thursday for Los Héroes de la Casa, in Spanish, Roxy will be here Thursday to bring it to you if you'd like to see that. And here we are. So the roof, this is what we're going to be talking about today. This is a beautiful roof here. You got the nice presidential shingles. What we're doing is when we're walking up to the property, we just want to be looking at a few things. So this is my cover photo here. This is one of my favorite shingles, you know, comp shingle. It's a great value. What you get for the wear, the weathering, being able to walk on it, and the look. Like, this is an architectural shingle here. It's called the Presidential Series. I just love it. I think it's a classic look. It looks good from far away. They're nice, thick shingles. And again, you can walk on them. It's, you know, they're a little bit heavier than some of the cheaper materials out there. But if you're doing one layer, you still are in good shape to be putting solar on and not have to worry about it. You know, if you guys have questions about your roof, what type of roof you have, if you're noticing anything, feel free. Reach out, shoot me a quick message. If you guys want to send me a photo, I'm cool. I know it's probably dark out there everywhere right now. But yeah, if you guys have questions, please reach out. So this is what we're looking at. I walk up, this is a great lay. It looks like, you know, it's new. You know, it looks like it was done right. You know, personally, I wish they would have cut this edge over here a little bit, nice and straight, but that's just me. And, oh, geez, I went roll through. What we see a lot, you know, especially entry-level homes, we'll see what's called a three-tab roof. This shingle, it's the entry-level shingle. A lot of times in windier areas, we'll see these displaced because they're very thin. Wind can get under them. So when we're in the Fontanas, you know, North Fontana, Ranch Cucamonga, you know, a lot of those areas, I'm really looking at the three-tab. You know, they'll lift really easily. A lot of times we'll see patching slightly different colored shingles because they've already had to do some repairs. And normally the home inspection will call out, you know, yeah, it was done improperly, or there's exposed nails. They need to have a little bit more service on it. But that's what we're looking at. What type of roof is it? Is it a nice thick shingle architectural? Is it the cheaper shingle, which normally comes with a shorter or, you know, or less of a warranty as well? Or is it something like this? I know this is kind of hard to see. It's a little granulated of a photo, but this is a steel shingle. It's a metal shingle with granules on it. So it looks very much like an asphalt shingle roof. People get confused all the time. They think it's, you know, either wood shake, or they think it's, you know, asphalt, but this is steel. It's a metal roof, and, you know, they've got some of their own issues and stuff, you know, but it's pretty good. They come with long warranties. If I see it, I'm normally pretty happy. I know my clients normally aren't going to have to mess with it if it was installed properly. You have to remember the number one place that a roof will leak is in the penetrations. Every roof has penetrations. So around your chimney, You know, if it's on the side of your house, if it's in the middle of your house, you've got a roof coming down, you've got a big flat spot that the water hits. So you need to either build up what's called a, you know, a cricket that it's a nice big V, so the water comes up and diverts each way, or you have to have it angled one way or the other. A lot of those times you've got flashing up there. Around the flashing, you got mastic, which is kind of like, let's call it a tar. They have different materials other than tar now. But you've got some sort of sealant, but you need flashing. So the water always is rolling down and can't get into any sort of crack. And then it goes down the side with a stepped flashing or something like that, which are a bunch of just metal pieces that are, you know, lined up in a row, just like shingles, to get that water off of your roof. So you've got chimney penetrations, you know, you've got vents. So every home, you've got, you know, maybe a heater vent. You've got from your kitchen, you know, exhaust fan vents, bathroom exhaust fan vents. You've got vents for your plumbing. There are all kinds of penetrations. And then obviously if you've got, you know, like a solo tube or skylights, things like that, you know, if they were built in right with the right curb, really this should be low maintenance. But you want to look on your roof. If you guys are an existing homeowner, you know, you need to have somebody look at your roof every couple of years. Have them go up there and look and make sure that the seals around those penetrations are not getting old and cracking, because that is the number one location for leaks on a roof. So I'm looking right here. All right, we got metal roof, no big deal. If it's installed properly, I'm happy. Then you've got Spanish tile. One of the issues with Spanish tile is, you know, if you're walking on it, there's a good chance you're going to break these tiles. You really need to be a professional to walk on it. My 220-pound body is not going on a Spanish tile roof. I just don't do it. I've got bad luck. I tend to break them. But what's nice about here is you can, just like any other roof, surface it properly. You can pull these out with a nail. You can slowly lift the other ones and nail another Spanish tile underneath. Again, I see the same thing. I'll see different covered tiles, patchwork on roofs. A lot of times people will take tile off the back, move it to the front, and then put the discolored ones on the back where you don't see them. But, you know, Spanish tile, again, the material itself is gonna last a long time. But that being said, let me step back. The real waterproofing feature of any roof is actually the tar paper underneath it. And we'll show a photo of that in a little bit. But on a Spanish tile, what will actually go out first is not the Spanish tile, it's the tar paper underneath, which basically just allows the water to come off and not soak in to the premises. But when that paper goes bad, either weather, just oxygenated, things like that, it'll start allowing the water to get in, soak it in itself, and it loses its waterproofing. And so what you can do actually with Spanish tile, which is pretty cool here, is you can actually lift up. They basically go in and take off all those Spanish tiles, they put down more paper, and then they turn around and they put those Spanish tiles back on. So if you need to do a new roof with Spanish tile, it's normally a little bit less expensive on materials because you can reuse the materials. But it's gonna be a little bit more costly on labor because they're just doing a lot more on the tear off. They have to be careful with that, and it's heavy material. So labor is gonna be more, but material is gonna be a lot less. So this is one of the things we're looking for. You know, if you're near a golf course, it's gonna look just like this. If you're in an area where you get hail, it'll look like this. You know, those impacts will crack it, and some just crack with time. You know, you've got, you know, just the expansion and contraction of heat in the cold and things like that too. So. And here's another concrete tile. This is a flat concrete tile. It's actually one of my favorite looks. Again, you gotta be careful walking on it. Here you can see some cracks, some snaps. And again, this is, you know, fairly easy to go in and remedy. You just, you know, slowly lift up these back ones, pull these out, and nail in some replacement shingles. So one of the things you have to worry about with these roofs are if they weren't original to the house. A lot of these tile roofs are heavy. Now, they make more expensive and newer tiles that are lightweight, composite and concrete. And those are pretty good because they're very lightweight and they can go on an older house that was designed for a wood shake roof. But I see it very regularly where you'll go into a house and it's just like, what is this, like a clown house or something? You got these rollers all through the house, and you can see exactly where every roof rafter is up there, and they bow up and down. And it's because the house was designed for a lightweight wood shake roof, and they turn around and they put on one of the first generation, normally, heavy Spanish tile roofs, or even recently they put it on and they just had somebody who didn't know what they were doing and sold them just the cheaper, heavier material. And you really, I'll call that out all the time. And that's one of the things you want to look for. So when we're walking up, that's it. We want to look at what type of roof is it? Because every roof will let us know, hey, when can we potentially expect to have to, you know, deal with the shingles themselves? You know, what type of age am I going to get out of them? I can eyeball it pretty well. I always like asking the inspector. And again, this is no, alternative. Just walking through, watching my video, you know, walk in with your agent is no alternative for getting a true professional home inspection. You want somebody who's going to walk through, look in the attic, you know, pull up the shingle layers, pull up the first layer. Sometimes they don't have the right, you know, especially when there's overlays, they don't have the right tar paper down on the first layer. We've seen all kinds of crazy thing, not having the proper venting. You got to remember, your roof gets beat on by that sun. So it needs to have proper ventilation, because when it gets hot, it needs to be able to let that air out. It also needs to cool. But if you don't have enough roof vents, you can literally have that roof expand like a balloon, and you'll hear a lot of creaking and stuff. And then it, you know, as it's cooler in the night, you'll start to hear all that framing, you know, creak and crack as it goes back down. So you want to make sure you've got proper venting. It's one of the things the inspectors are going to be checking for, as well as leaks. You know, when you walk into a home and you're like, all right, this home looks fantastic, no leaks in the ceiling. Well, they might have just painted that recently, or it's leaking and that whole ceiling's about to come down. So when they're up there in the attic, they're looking around and they can see, yeah, there's a leak here and it's pooling, but it just hasn't been enough yet to make it through that drywall ceiling. Or if you've got an older home and it's lath and plaster ceiling, the water just hasn't come through yet. So you're on borrowed time, and that's why you want to get that inspection. So, but this is what it talks about. So when we go into a home, we always try and look at the shingles if they're visible from ground level. And I want to see how many layers of roof are there. This, as you can see, there's 1, 2, 3 layers of roof here. So when they're starting to get leaks on one, maybe the granules are starting to go missing. And this is a great photo too. You can see up here where there's some black spots. These are granules on top of the asphalt, you know, tar roof. They, over time, they'll start to come off. It's not as big of a deal on, you know, steeper sloped roofs, but on a flatter roof, it's more of an issue. And, you know, it's just going to allow this asphalt here, shingle to deteriorate. Sometimes you can see the fiberglass and stuff like that inside of it as well. It'll deteriorate faster. So as you start to see the degranulation, you kind of know you're probably halfway through the life of that shingle. And it kind of gives you some telltale wear signs and how much time you might have left on that shingle set. So here you've got 3 layers. What does that matter? I've got 3 roofs. That's got to be 3 times as good as 1, right? Not necessarily. You know, in theory, yeah, you've got, you know, more layers that water's got to get through. A lot of times they're just throwing another layer on to mask a leak that was possibly something else. Like we talked about, it's potentially a roof penetration. You know, water is crazy. Just because you see a stain on the ceiling over here doesn't mean that's where the leak is. It's not up in this corner. It's over there. You know, because water is going to go downhill, and it's going to keep going downhill and find, you know, imperfections and drywall, cracks in drywall, whatever it might be. You might notice a roof leak that's from the ridge cap, you know, and it's all of a sudden it's in your wall or in your window because the water is coming all the way down, you know, the bottom of, let's say, your roof. It's hitting your top plate on your wall and it's coming down there. And then it finally can't get through because it's hitting a window flashing and it's coming inside the drywall. We've seen some crazy things, you know, that have shown themselves other places. So again, that's why you want to have an inspector, but multiple layers. One thing it is doing is it's adding extra weight on your roof. Back in the day, some cities would allow up to 3 layers on a roof before they would make you take it down, because it's putting undue weight and stress on your roof rafters and your framing. If your home, you know, is older and was designed for a wood shake roof, the 50s, 60s, 70s, even some of the early 80s, they primarily were wood shake roofs, and they were designed for very lightweight because that wood shake is very light. So they weren't designed to have three layers of asphalt shingle that's now, you know, an inch or 2 inches thick on that roof. So you're gonna create framing problems. You'll see broken roof rafters, all kinds of huge structural issues, and it can become very, you know, very big issue, especially when you start getting into earthquakes and things like that. So you wanna make sure you don't have too much weight on your roof. Plus, why cities now are starting to make it to where you can only have one or two layers. Some cities are only one layer now. And the reason is they want everybody to be able to put on solar very easily. And that's more weight on that roof. So they wanna make sure that everybody's roof has the smallest amount of weight possible so you can put on that solar without having to do a re-roof down the road. So they wanna make it very easy to go to solar. So if you guys have any questions, wanna give a shout out. What's up, JP? What's up, Bertha? Bill Ham, Preston Moore, good seeing you guys. Digoberto, Angelica, Ronald. What's up, Ruby? Love it. Rafael, oh, he says, I'm there now doing deliveries tonight to Penny Pinch everywhere I can. Dude, Rafael, dude, peace, bro. I remember those days. So I cut every little expense. And what's funny is that's actually why I got in real estate. You know, I was trying to buy properties to renovate, to rent, and then to flip, and agents just didn't understand what I was trying to get at. Like, I want something with some like added value that I could add to this property. Like, I want to be able to put in some sweat equity and turn it for a profit, and they didn't get it. And so when I started searching for homes, I just went out on my own. And then that's when I actually decided to turn around and get my real estate license, because I wanted access to these listings, because these agents didn't know anything and they were driving me crazy. I knew more than they did because I was just reading all kinds of books on real estate, and I'm like, hey, and I want to save the commission too. So that's what got me into real estate. I'm like, well, hey, if I can get paid for doing what I want to be doing, I'm going to go this route. And so I was already doing a little investing at the time in real estate, and I said, hey, this is the route for me. So, but I remember it. And you know, and that's one of the things when you guys are, you know, interviewing your agent, your lender, ask them if they're a homeowner. You know, they just don't know what it's like to, you know, have that anxiety of buying your home. Am I gonna get my offer accepted? You're nervous, and then you've got the finance issues. You know, some of these people out there, you know, they don't even own their own home. And on top of it, you know, they just do this day in and day out and they get desensitized. Like, I remember it. I remember it very well. And when I'm working, especially with these first-time home buyers, and I see it, like, I know what you're going through. Like, I remember being there like it was yesterday. I remember my wife crying at the house we bought because she didn't like the color of the carpet. And I'm like, don't worry, babe, I'm gonna fix that. We're gonna do these things. You know, I remember her crying the night we got our offer accepted because she didn't like the house, you know? And then 2 years later, when we were moving up because we made good money on it from all the upgrades, she's like, I really like this house now. I could stay here, you know? So I feel you, Rafael. It's good seeing you. Thank you guys for joining us. Abayer, what's up, Michael, Fao? Yeah, if you guys have any questions, please shoot them out. Any comments? What's up, Stephanie? And if you got any likes, please hit the like button, the love button. Wanna send men our love here too. So this is multiple layers. This is what it looks like in a bad scenario. This is how I see it on the entry-level homes a lot of times. And you've got multiple issues going on there. And this is a roof penetration. So you should see, I should have sent a picture of a good one, but you should have a flashing around here where the water is getting pushed out and away from the roof. It should be underneath. This is a layer on top of a layer. Underneath there's a flashing, but it's hidden. So even though you've got a new roof layer on, that water is still going underneath right here into your old roof layer. That's one of the things, you know, you just look at it and you shake your head and you know this wasn't done properly. There was no permit. And that's one of the things too, is when you've got three layers, you normally know it's not done without a permit. It's probably gonna leak faster. The shingles also tend to wear faster because there's extra heat just from them being stacked on top of each other. They don't stay as cool. So there's just multiple issues, and that's what we're looking at. So you guys can walk through this house and you can look up and go, okay, does it look like it's one of these? You know, this is an asphalt shingle. It's called composition because there's multiple materials. You got some fiberglass, you got some tar, you got some pebbles. So is it comp shingle or is it one of my tiles? Is it a Spanish tile? Is it, you know, a flat tile, you know, flat concrete tile? Is it a metal? You know, if you're in, you know, where it snows a lot of areas, they've got the flat metal, you know, with the ribs on it. A lot of commercial facilities have that. I didn't even throw it in here because we don't see it on much of the you know, under millions of dollars properties. So these are things you need to be looking at. And then from there, can you see how thick it is? Sometimes you can't tell because they put a drip edge, the metal drip edge around the edge of it. You're only gonna see one layer. But if you lift up in between, you can see the two. Sometimes when you've got a low overhang on a porch, I can actually lift up and see. It's kind of nice being 6 foot and having arms that are like 9 feet long on top of it. But you should still be able to look and see. Also underneath, I'll turn around and I'll look underneath the eaves where the roof comes out. Are there boards there? Is it wood shake there? Sometimes you can get a little glimpse of what's going on underneath it there. Because what you don't want is you don't want this comp shingle overlay to be on top of wood shake. Because when you go to remove it, because we know the city's only going to allow one or two layers, next time you need to put a roof on, you got to remove it all. So you've got to take off this composition shingle, and then you've got to go and rip off all this wood shake. That's not the biggest problem. Next problem is you have to put on plywood decking. You have to go and fully make that whole roof solid to put on any of the newer materials. So you're gonna have an extra cost on that roof replacement. So that's something we just like to just call out to our clients. Hey, look, it's not leaking, it's in good condition, but just beware when it's time for you to replace, no surprises here, you're gonna need to redeck it, and that's gonna add a couple more $1,000 in material. So, and here we go. So this one here, as you can see, it's a Spanish tile roof. And notice how it peaks up at the end here. This is a sag. So you've got all of the roof, rafters through here are sagging. Actually, I should be pointing at this one over here. All these roof rafters over here are sagging. And then at the end, where this is still supported by a wall underneath here and can support all the weight better, it's nice and solid. So that's one of the things you want to be looking at when you're looking at, these roofs is, hey, is it too much weight for your existing, house structure? And then this one here, what this is showing is what's called a radiant barrier. So when I'm, looking at a house, we're in the garage, this is normally where I'm going to see it. The inspector can see it when he does his inspection in the attic. But in the garage, a lot of times I'll look up and I'll see this metallic material underneath the roof. And this is what's called a radiant barrier. It's, newer relatively to the market, and it radiates back the heat. So it doesn't allow as much heat into your house. If you're putting on a new roof, highly recommend it. But what I like to point it out for is when I see that in a garage, I point that out right away and I say, hey, you know what? I know it looks like the roof's new from the outside, because it's probably within the last 10 years that they've been using this material, maybe a little bit more, but I feel like it hit mainstream about 10 years ago. I had a friend put it on about 15, 18 years ago, but we're seeing it more and more now. But you'll look up and I'll see it in the garage and I'll say, hey, look, that person spent the extra money on this roof to put in the radiant barrier, which means one, they're a sucker and they got sold. No, or really, hey, they did the roof right. They went with a good roofer who gave them that option, and they didn't just cut corners. So when you have a seller who's not cutting corners on an expensive roof, normally they didn't cut corners on other things they've done to that house. And it's just kind of like one more sign that I like to see, and I always point that out to my clients, that hey, there's some attention to detail here and some pride of ownership. So if you see radiant barrier, that's a good thing in my eyes from top to bottom. And this is what it would look like, looking up from an attic or inside a garage framing. You got this silver metallic, it'll say like LP on it or whatever, but that's what you want to be looking for there. And this is wood shake. So, we talked about wood shake. I see wood shake on multi-million dollar homes. I see $20 million homes. They got wood shake on it, normally near the beach. They did away with it. Wood shake's actually a really good material. When it gets wet, it swells, it seals everything up. And it's lightweight and it just looks cool. I really like the look, so if you've got an older home, in an area where it's not high fire, primarily near the beach communities, it's pretty cool to use. So people are still doing it. They still install it. Here's a nice solid wood shake. What I wanted to call out on this photo is what the decking looks like underneath. See, you've got these gaps and these slats here, and those gaps and that slats are what these wood shake get nailed to. And here's the different layers of tar paper on this style. So when you go to, when you just do an overlay on wood shake, you're just putting new paper, hopefully, over your wood shake, and then that asphalt shingle on top of it. I can normally call out a comp shingle overlay over the wood shake roof, because all of the shingles have that swaying it up and down, because underneath it, it's not a nice flat, flat solid surface. So you got all this waviness. And again, it can wear those asphalt shingles a little bit faster. So definitely not recommended by the manufacturer. They want to see it on that flat plywood backing. So when you rip off a shake roof, now you've got all these slats. You can't have that in an asphalt roof, a comp shingle. So you're going to have to either fill these slats or put new plywood on top. Normally, it's cheaper just to put plywood on top. And so here you go. You can see they ripped off a shake roof here, and they are now putting on the decking, it's called, the plywood, to then turn around and put on the roof. And it's got to be, quote unquote, 3/4. This is kind of funny because in this photo, they got 3-stripe white here. I know at Home Depot, it's got 5 stripes of brown. So if you see your guys put it on, it's from Home Depot. It should have 5 brown stripes on it to have the right thickness. But, I'm glad they didn't put on a Spanish tile here, because these golf balls over here probably would have cracked it pretty fast. So especially if Troy or I are around. But once the decking goes in, this is your true waterproofing material. This is the tar paper. One more thing on Spanish tile. I had a photo. Here's a guy ripping off the Spanish tile and putting it back on. So just know that it can be done. So if you guys have any questions, shoot them out. That's pretty much end of what we wanted to go over tonight. And again, it's the 5 things you need to look for. It's electrical. There are certain things you can visually look at when you walk through the house for the first time. It takes no more than 2 to 3 minutes, and you can know a lot about that electrical system and what costs you might have coming down the pipe. Then you can look at plumbing. Again, 2 or 3 minutes as you're walking through. From the very first thing I do when I'm pulling that key out of the lockbox, I'm looking at the plumbing that lockbox is normally attached to. And then I'm looking at a couple of things throughout the house. Then you want to look, obviously, at the roof as you're walking up. So these are all quick visual. Oh, what type of material does it have? Huh, does there look like there's anything crazy going on? Great, now I know what condition the roof's in. Let's walk in and check out the house. And then you've got foundation. There are certain telltale signs. And if you guys have been watching our Instagram, please like and follow us on our Instagram at The House Heroes. We put up a lot of these real estate tips of the day. And we've been putting a lot of the roof ones on here recently. And we just did a foundation one a couple days ago. I think it's still on our posts. And that one, it had major cracks outside the house. And you could tell that the soils had expansion and contraction and things were moving. And then when you walk inside, sure enough, they had band-aided over all kinds of stuff. You could see where there was patchwork on the drywall. You could see where in the corners, the seams were slipping. You could see where they had travertine tile flooring that looked different in a couple spots than others. Obviously, it had cracked and they had replaced them with newer materials. So there are things you can just visually see. You don't need to have an inspector. You don't need to spend $400 to know that right off the bat. Again, you still want to get that home inspection. They're going to be a lot more thorough. They have a checklist. They're going in the attic. They're going in the crawl space. They're going to spend a lot more time at that property. They're going to test every outlet. They're going to check temperatures. They're going to do all that stuff. But there's things you should be able to see when you walk through the house to know if it's even worth wasting your time putting an offer in on. So you got your electrical, you got your plumbing, you got your roof, you've got your foundation, and then you want to look at your HVAC. That's another big ticket system item that you can, visibly see when you're walking through that property. And you want to make sure that if you've got any concerns, you're addressing them right off the bat. So I want to give a couple more shout outs. What's up, Javier, Christy, Eddie? What's up, King Pablo, Victor, Hari? What's up, Jackie, Carlos Granadas? What's up, Tha? What's up, Joaquin? I love it. What's up, Irene Levy? I think we just spoke the other day. So congrats on getting your home search started there. So and then Clayman, what's up? Congrats on the closing. So you guys are all dialed in. Rachel. All right, so I'm gonna wind it down here. If you guys haven't already followed us on The House Heroes, please go on there, follow us there. Definitely follow us on Instagram. Next week we're gonna have the final of the 5 things, it's foundation. If you guys want to see the previous 4, please go to our YouTube. It's the easiest way to search it. You can scroll back on our Facebook, but there's other posts to get buried and things like that. YouTube's the place to go. So please check us out, which is now, I believe, YouTube and then / The House Heroes. on YouTube, and definitely subscribe there, because that way you'll get notified as new content gets posted. So if you miss one of the lives, you'll at least be notified of it. So thank you guys for joining us. If you guys got any more questions or shout outs, bring them at me. Other than that, hope you guys are doing well out there. And remember, the market's still hot, but now is the time window to be out there and be aggressive, because I feel that there's a few less offers going in. I feel like people are starting to rope things in and being reasonable on their offers. And only the serious buyers tend to buy real estate through the holidays. So remember that. Only the real sellers are out there selling. You know, most people, you know, that are just trying to get some crazy offer accepted on their home, they pull them off for Christmas. They pull them off for Thanksgiving, especially during COVID. They don't want people traipsing through their homes. So if a home is listed right now, going into the holidays, you have a serious seller. You know, the buyers out there aren't the ones that are all hyped up, you know, from the spring excitement and things like that. You've got serious buyers. So if you're looking to sell, it's still a great time to sell. If you're looking to buy, it's a fantastic time to buy. You know, everybody's asking me in March and April, hey, I heard towards the end of the year is a better time. Yes, in theory, there are normally less buyers out there, but you have the problem. We had a price run up all the way from March to now, and it's not being given back. So yes, prices are going to be still strong, but get out there and battle it out. If you guys are in the market, don't give up. And if you have any questions, please reach out to Wham, to Min and the Wham fam out there for you. And then us as well at the House Heroes. So thank you guys all. Peace and God bless.